Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Live at the Whiskey Lounge. My name is Steve Rashid. I'm your host, and I will be your host all evening. We are here every Thursday. Thank you so much for coming out and supporting live music, and particularly supporting live jazz here as part of this series. We do these little concerts. We've been doing it. In fact, Don, you don't know this, but I did some math on the way just before I came here, because I keep kind of spouting off these numbers about how many shows we've done. We've been here for about a year and a half. And we're here celebrating Don Stille's 70th birthday. This is our 70th show. Can you believe that? How about that? That was entirely unplanned, but I'll take full credit. So we have been here almost every week for the last year and a half. It all started, I'm a musician myself, and I was playing on that, I have nothing to do with this club, but this beautiful club, by the way, I wish I did, but I don't. I was playing on that beautiful stage downstairs for another event, and walked upstairs and saw this room and thought it was gorgeous, and thought, gosh, wouldn't it be great, wouldn't this be a nice room for a jazz series? So I approached the management about it, and they were into it, so here we are, 70 shows later. Oh, we're good? Okay. That's my friend Carl Ross, ladies and gentlemen, who is handling the video end of things. And in fact, that's a good segue. Let me just kind of quickly tell you what's going on with all these thousands of microphones and these little guys. We do a full audio recording of every show. Much the way we do in a recording studio. I bring nice microphones from my studio and we set it up. And the recordings I used are available to the musicians for archival purposes. So we do it for archival purposes. They can use it for their promotional purposes if they like. It's up to them. And then also we have these cameras. We have four or five cameras every week that we set up, and we do a live video streaming is available. So these little table cards you see on your little tables there, you can certainly take them with you. Gives you information about the series, and there's a website listed here. And if you look at that website, it'll tell you what's coming up in the upcoming shows, and it will give you the archive of all the previous shows. So if you'd like to go back and see something that we've done previously, you can do that. That's about it for me. I'm going to come back at the end of the first set, and we're going to do a little bit of a Q&A. We always do that with the artists, and so we get to know them a little bit, invite your questions if you like. And Don is going to start alone, but he's going to be bringing up a fantastic violinist, Daniela Bisenius. I'm so thrilled. We're going to get into this a little later in the Q&A, but I can't tell you how thrilled I am to have Don here as part of this series. Something that's been on my mind for a long time, and what a great reason to bring him, particularly tonight with his birthday coming up. A mutual friend of ours tipped me off that it was Don's birthday coming up, so I wanted to, that would be really a great thing to be able to have him here, and it was our honor to be able to have Don Stille here. So we'll find out more about Don later, but for now, I think everybody would love to hear him play. So give it up for the great Don Stille.
Thank you. Man, I wish I would have practiced. I'll play, then we'll talk. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So that was entitled, that was a tune called Django, written by John Lewis of modern jazz quartet fame. And it was his homage to Django Reinhardt, the great gypsy jazz guitarist. So I thought, what better way to introduce this program, which is, well, it's not all dedicated to gypsy jazz, there'll be other forms too, but I'm about to introduce my good friend and musical soulmate, a wonderful gypsy jazz violinist and good classical, and a wonderful person besides. Would you please welcome Daniela Bisenius. So we are going to get to stay with Django, actually. This is a piece, we kind of had some tug and pull when we were rehearsing a little bit. I guess it's like an old, young kind of thing, fast, slow, 70, what are you, 35?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, but I opted for something a little slow, and I think we worked it out. So,
we'll
and,
see.
Yeah, and you're going to kick it off, right?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
Nice and slow.
Okay. Thank you. Daniela Bisenius.
We got problems already? Thank you. Sounds good.
Now that was obviously, we started that sort of medley. A little showbiz, you can't blame us, you know. That was Nuage, the Django Reinhardt composition. It was born out of the war years under Hitler's reign. And I guess it was a song of optimism. Nuage means cloud, of course. And there's some controversy as to whether it's plural or singular. I've seen both titles several times, but mostly I refer to it as Nuage. The next piece, of course, was Minor Swing, which was also the first, it was first entitled Fat, whatever that means. I don't know whose idea that was, but became Minor Swing. I think it was a wise choice. So right now, we're going to do another tune. This is definitely, by the very title, Gypsy in Nature. It's more of a American pop culture kind of piece. And it's entitled The Gypsy. And hope you like it.
You want to start writing to it, or? I can do it.
How about that? All right, we're going to change the pace. This is just kind of a tune we enjoy playing because it's just a nice little love song. It's a Latin in flavor. And so let's see, yeah, Like a Lover, that's what it is. Like a Lover.
Thank you.
Thank you. Like a lover. Is that okay, Flavia?
Yeah.
All right, we're just going to need to step it up a little bit. So we're going to do a nice... Jangle did record this one several times. It's a nice little quiet thing called After You've Gone. Thank you. Thank you. I have the same problem.
You're too tall.
I'm not going there.
It's a trick microphone.
All right, we're back in business. I'm going to do another little solo thing that I enjoy doing, providing it works out right. This is a simple country tune that for some reason hits home for me. And I should, before, it's kind of a sad song, but I'm going to preface it by, a lot of people ask me how I got started in this, with this particular instrument. And so I think it's a good idea maybe if I share that. I started this when I was 5 years old, and quite by accident. I had a terrible coordination problem before that. I mean, alternating lifting a knife and a fork at the dinner table was virtually impossible and painful. And one night, a door-to-door accordion salesman knocked at the door. And there were such things.
Are you kidding?
Seriously.
No.
Seriously.
No.
I wouldn't kid you.
And he's here tonight.
So my dad, in his infinite wisdom, said, I don't know about the music aspect, but maybe it'd take care of his coordination problem. So he signed me up, and actually within a week, the coordination issue was virtually gone, and I was improvising by that time, and then that was it. On the next major milestone as a youngster accordion player was my first major composition, which was entitled The I Love You March. Yeah. I was 6 years old, and I was madly in love with the wife of my next door neighbor. So I thought, what better way to, earn some extra points? She was pregnant at the time. Now, this is where it gets weird. She was pregnant at the time, and I really was hoping it was my child she was carrying. I knew nothing about such things. I just something told me I would want that. So anyway, on to a very sad song. This is a Hank Williams tune entitled I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry. And I did many times. I invite Danielle back, as we can see.
What do we play?
How are we doing? Yeah, okay. Why don't we do honeysuckle?
We'll go back to, wait a minute.
Let's do one note.
We'll do for Flavia. This is the one note samba. How do you say that in...
That's a phenomenon.
What was that again?
It's easy for you to say.
What she said.
What she said. Not fast.
Be flat.
Don Stille, Daniela Bisenius. So fantastic. Gosh, my head is swimming with questions. You know, I'd love to know something about Daniela and your connection to Don and all that, but I'd love, if it's all right with you, I'm going to start with Don a little bit, because I'd love to know a little bit more about what you were talking about the coordination thing and about when you first started playing the accordion, because one of the things, I'm a keyboard player, and one of the things that has always interested me is with accordions, what happens, what's up with the left hand? I mean, what is going on there, you know? So can you talk just a little bit about the instrument and how that works?
This particular instrument, this is the, I guess some call it the piano accordion because of the piano keyboard. A lot of you are probably used to seeing buttons on both sides or some kind of array of, some sort of a keyboard other than a piano keyboard, but this was probably the most popular, and especially in this country. And as far as the buttons are concerned, this particular version has the two bass rolls on the inside. And then,
which, by the way, makes no sense to me.
It's titled the major bass roll and a counter bass roll. The roll closest to the switches is the counter bass roll. And it's sort of it makes certain things, certain patterns, logistically easier to do. If I were trying to do a simple root third fifth without the counter bass roll, would be that doable, but kind of clumsy. But the counter bass roll comes in, and things are shifted, so I could just do it this way. That type of thing.
Now, so it's putting common patterns in close proximity. Is that basically
right.
What it's doing?
It's a convenience kind of roll, and it enables you to use various combinations of the two. You know, if I play a C major chord, I can go to an A minor 7 real quick, or an A minor 7 flat 5. And do all the harmonic variations. And you need the other four rolls because the third roll is major chord, minor chord, seventh chord, diminished. And then you combine different ones to get different chord qualities and different bass chord combinations.
So some of the buttons give one pitch, some of them give you a full chord.
Right. On this one, now they have the all bass accordion, where every note is like a single,
single note,
yeah, and you have to manually construct your chords, which is a very good thing.
So are there many different styles of left-hand architecture for accordions, or
there really are, and some are very complicated, and it's all complicated by the fact that no matter which one you choose, you never see the bass roll. I mean, you never see what's going on up here. You got to learn it strictly by feel.
Holy cow.
And that's why, you know, sometimes it's a struggle. If I don't hear it clear enough, I don't know quite where I'm at. So, which is probably my story of life in general. But
well, it's what, you know, what's fascinating to me is that helped you solve your coordination problem. I mean, if I were to try that, I'd be falling over. I mean, that's really complicated. So you must have, I mean, that was a lot of thinking that had to be going on, right?
I guess based on what we probably know today, there's certain connections that, in a case like that aren't made up in the brain. And the accordion, being the amazing instrument that it is, enabled these connections to be made, and actually pretty quickly. So, because they are, I mean, there's two different things going on.
Vastly different things.
Vastly different while you're pumping air through everything.
Yeah. And I don't want to get too into the weeds here with this, but every time you press a key and force air through with the bellows, it's pushing air through past a reed.
Right.
Correct? I mean,
right.
It's a reed instrument like a harmonica would be, or like those. I mean, maybe you've seen those little keyboards you blow into that with a keyboard that's called a melodica. That they're all reed instruments. It's a reed based, right?
Right.
So if you're expanding or contracting the bellow, is it right? Am I calling
right.
it bellow? If you're expanding or contracting the bellows, is it accessing different sets of reeds? Are
right.
they going different directions then?
Out or in with the bellows, you get the same tone. Depressing a key or depressing a button opens the passage to that reed.
I see.
The air blows through that reed, and that's the one that sounds.
I see.
Now, this is a four reed accordion, low reed, two middle. One of the middles is detuned a little bit for Parisian stuff. uh-huh. and in a high read.
Can you give a quick little example? By the way, forgive me. Every week I come up and I do these little things and I go off on these tangents about things that actually really interest me. So hopefully they're at least slightly interesting. Okay, good. Thank you. All right, good. So could you just give a quick little demonstration of the different reads of different settings?
Okay.
And this is, correct me if I'm wrong, this is kind of like a church organ or something where you'd have different sets of yeah. sounds that you would get depending on which stops you're using, correct?
Exactly. Okay. And, all right, my favorite jazz read is the low read.
Okay.
And there's a piccolo read. I mean, that sometimes it's probably useful, but I don't use it that much.
Be good for calling your dog.
Yeah. then there's a combination of the one middle reed and the high reed, and this is the one I use for tangos. And then a kind of a variation of my favorite jazz reed, if I want, well, like on So Lonesome I Could Cry, use the just a middle, straight middle reed.
Okay. Oh, mellower, uh-huh.
Beautiful. Now, I talked about that detuned middle reed, and this is where this comes in handy.
Detuned meaning you've got two reeds that are going simultaneously, but they're slightly out of tune with each other for
right,
the same pitch?
Exactly. Okay. And it's kind of the musette effect for.
Can you play oh, I see.
And so forth and so on.
Can I have a glass of Chardonnay, please? That's really nice. That's really
and
nice.
I have other combinations which I don't use as often, but they're there if I want them.
Do you know why was it that the musette sound became associated with a Parisian style of playing?
I don't think I do.
Aha! Stump the band. I love that.
I'm 70. I forgot. I'm sorry.
You can use that excuse for a long time.
Oh yeah, I'm milking.
By the way, and this is was not an intentional segue, but one of the and I've had several wonderful musical experiences with Don. I make most of my living as a composer, and one of the great experiences that I got to have with Don was I was hired several years ago to write the music for a film written by Brad Hall, who was a Los Angeles-based screenwriter and director, and he's the husband of Julia Louis-Dreyfus, and she was the star of the film. Brad wrote it and directed it, and it's called Picture Paris, and it takes place partly in Los Angeles and partly in Paris, and so we, of course, needed the sound of an accordion, so who else would you call? So we got Don in, and Don came in and played this beautiful, beautiful French score for us, and it was so nice. And as a matter of fact, I let Brad know earlier today that it was your birthday. Unfortunately, Julia's not around, but Brad did send me something, and I'd like to share it with you if I could.
Absolutely. Aww.
Let's see if I can. Give me one second. This is going to be a little clumsy.
I think he should take up accordion.
Okay, so I don't know if you're going to be able to see this. But I'm going to at least play it so that Don can see it and we can show it to you.
Oh, Don.
The speaker is on this.
Do you have my accordion? I'll tell you what you do have. You have a birthday today. Happy birthday. 10th birthday. Oh, no. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. Do you have my accordion? Come on. I'll tell you what you do have. Happy birthday. You have a birthday today. Happy birthday. 10th birthday. Oh, no. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70? Come on. Uh-huh. Happy birthday.
Oh, man. Thank you.
He did that literally with about 10 minutes notice. Oh, so God.
Thank you, Brad.
And Julia sends her love too, but she wasn't there when he did that, unfortunately. So I wish I would have only thought of that sooner. Danielle, how did you two get connected? And in fact, I'm going to have to walk over there to be able to share a microphone.
We can get connected.
Do you remember?
We wound up on a gig that we both hated.
You know what usually is really, what was really fun in these situations is to separate them and get each of their story. Go ahead.
Oh. Hi.
Hey. I think we were, we found each other a few years ago on a French gig, so to speak, and we were both not pleased very well, you know. But after a few years after, 2 years after that, you know, we got to play together at Gaetano's, right?
Well,
and we play there once a month on both locations. He's got two restaurants, one in Forest Park and one in Batavia. So we've been playing that and kind of developed, I must say, a musical chemistry that in all these years, and I played quite a few years, I have not found in anyone else. And I love you.
Yeah.
He is, I am so humbled to be here besides him, and anywhere else I would have to share the stage. He could have had anybody here, you know. So, but what can I say, you know? Okay, you take it. I'm not
So it sounds like you were just happened to be on the same gig together, and that's and you met that way, and
right.
And realized that you enjoyed playing together, and
yes,
and
we
kept,
liked what
kept
each
going.
Other did, but we didn't like the gig.
I see, and that happens.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I meant. See.
Right.
Language. Okay.
And you're Romanian. That's, you're
yes,
Romanian.
I am.
Wow.
I'm a violinist by day and a vampire by night.
I love that. How many years have you used that line?
just
tonight. Oh, that's great. Does anybody out there have any questions?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
For Don, in terms of musical inspirations, I'm sure you get the obvious accordion question about accordion players, but I hear a lot of vocal qualities in your playing, and I'm curious if there's singers that you kind of might aspire to their attitude or sound or just that inspired you initially, and maybe accordion players, maybe another instrumentalist or something that you just, maybe that we would think of like a guitar player or something that would, I don't know. Are there people like that that really inspire you?
Yeah, that's a worthy question, actually. I mean, Art Van Damme, as everybody says, you know, when I played this or I played that, it sounded like Art Van Damme. I kind of hope not, but Art's a wonderful player, but it's not one of the people that I would say inspired me, but I do appreciate his composition, his contribution. I like horn players. If I'm doing a up-tempo solo, it's in the bebop area, I probably refer to several horn players that I've heard over the years. I love Keith Jarrett for his musicality, his musicianship, and his lyrical quality to his solos. And I guess that's Astor Piazzolla. Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, I loved all the great ones. Sarah Vaughan and Ella, of course, and Carmen McRae is actually probably my favorite singer because of her phrasing. And she's just so fluid and creative with it. It's just, and nothing, you know, intricate or complex, but just beautiful. And I also love Ray Charles. I think every vocalist, I don't care what you want to, which genre you want to follow, Ray Charles, you should spend some time with him.
Boy, that's a diverse crowd that you've just mentioned. It does come through in your playing. I mean, it's really, you have such a worldly quality. I love that you started with the tune Django. I just heard that song this afternoon. I was thinking, what a beautiful composition that is. And to hear it in your hands was so great because it's such a different sound coming out of an accordion,
right.
And it's so beautifully interpreted. I thought that was just gorgeous.
Thank you.
By the way, let us not forget, this is Don's birthday, and there is a ritual that we must go
yes.
through. So please, 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Thank you all.
Happy birthday.
It's a Greek birthday.
Wow.
Can I blow that out?
Oh, man. All three of them?
Someone pictures.
Yeah! Opa!
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
So thank you all for coming. Thank you for sticking around. There's a lot. There's another entire set of music. So please don't go anywhere. We really do appreciate you coming. And thank you to Don for coming and helping celebrate your birthday here. We are truly honored that you are here to be with us. And Daniela, what a beautiful, beautiful duet. Wonderful sound, both of you. And it's quite wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to say to Steve, thank you very much. I felt very honored that he thought of this, and it made me feel special. And I have a feeling he does that for everybody, because that's his way and his nature. And he's doing a great thing here, a great service. I hope everybody comes out to support it. I know I will, because this is something that should go on. It shouldn't go away quietly into the night. So. Make it a regular.
Well, thanks. We're having a ball doing it, and we honestly couldn't do it without your presence, and so it means a lot that you're here. And thanks, Don. I will come back right at the end of the break to tell you about what's coming up. There's a really great thing coming up next week as well, and on into the month. But for now, let's just give it up for Don and Daniela, and take a quick break and come back with a lot more music.
For my accordion. Where is my goddamn accordion? Oh, Don. Do you have my accordion? I'll tell you what you do have. You have a birthday today. Happy birthday. 10th birthday. Oh, no. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70? Come on. Happy birthday. Just looking for my accordion.
Yes. Folks, before Don and Daniela get started again, I thought I would just say a couple things. One is, first of all, thank you so much for your kind attention through this. We do really think of these as concerts, and we, like I said at the very beginning, in case you missed the beginning, we do record all these shows, and people really are here. We think of this as a listening room, so we certainly don't mean by any means you can't speak to the people next to you, but if you do, please do keep it down, because we do, believe it or not, pick that stuff up on the microphones. We would much rather record the musicians than your conversation. So we just thank you for that respect that you give the musicians, and it does help us. Secondly, I want to give you, just real briefly, tell you what's happening next week. We're going two different ends of the spectrum. Here's a guy who has had this wonderful, illustrious career and has played with a million people, and you know, we didn't even get into all the people you've played with and the many musical experiences you've had, but believe me, they are many, and quite honestly, I would rather hear Don play than anything else tonight. But next week, what we have coming is somebody at the other end, someone who is just beginning. This is her name is Eva B. Ross. She's 20 years old. And I've literally known her since she was an infant. And at a young age, she had one of those voices that was just pure and right in tune. And by her teenage years, she really was singing phenomenally well. And now she's a full-blown singer-songwriter. She goes to UCLA. She's actually daughter of dear friends of ours. But she has quite a following on campus at UCLA and is now coming to Chicago to do a handful of gigs. So we are honored to have her here next week. And I'll be here playing with her along with my good friends Don Sternberg and Jim Cox. So it's going to be a really fine group behind her. But Eva is really something, and she's going to be singing an evening of standards, which is going to be something really fun for all of us. So please do come back and check that out. It'll be a really fun night. Okay, now I'm getting out of the way. Don Stille, Daniela Bisenius, thank you so much.
Thank you. Since we talked about Parisian-flavored things, this is a French song. I can't say the French lyric or French title. I wouldn't even dare. I'll say right now, Autumn Leaves, and I'll ask Claudia, how do you say Autumn Leaves? That's right.
What she said.
Also what she said. It's so nice to hear it in French. So anyway, sometimes, Daniela, when we really connect is when we don't necessarily have a point of view on a piece necessarily. We just kind of see where it takes us. Maybe based on certain ways that we've done it in the past, but we don't get hung up on an arrangement per se. This can be good or bad, and we hope most of the time it can be good. So that's the way we're going to approach this piece. We've talked about Baroque, we've talked about more jazz, like Miles did it, this and that. It might be a little bit of everything, but it's still going to be, oh, and stay out. This is going to be Autumn Leaves. Thank you. Another hand for Daniela. She's something else. All right, this is a very beautiful piece that was composed by Oscar Peterson. He, I mean, on top of the fact that he had tremendous chops, and I guess many of you have heard the story that his idol was Art Tatum. And at a very young age, I guess he was maybe in his late teens, early 20s, he had occasion to hear Art Tatum live, and he was already playing, Oscar was, and he heard Art and went up to his room and stayed there for 3 weeks and said he would not play anymore. What a mistake that would have been, huh? But anyway, he had tremendous drive in his swing and lots of chops and lots of ideas and relentless energy, but he could write some of the most tender pieces on the face of the planet. And this is one of them. It's entitled When Summer Comes. And I will kind of have to read this, I'm sorry. It's a 70 thing. Thank you. Isn't that pretty? So we'll go back, change the tempo, boost it a bit, little fat swaller. Yeah, okay. We like that too. And I do believe Django has also recorded this one.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Fun.
We're going to do something from the pen of Billy Strayhorn now. This is something we just recently started doing. And it is just a heart-wrenching piece. And it's entitled Blood Count. And I guess the story has it that he was suffering from one of the blood diseases. And he was, a very young age. I mean, he wrote a lot of these things when he was in his teens. He was just deep. And I don't know what you could say, just right from the core, is just deep stuff. This is a piece that he wrote while he was at the Upper Manhattan Medical Group, waiting for a blood transfusion. And he wrote, composed Blood Count. The Upper Manhattan Medical Group also spawned another tune, UMMG, which was, many people have recorded that, Chicoria, and a host of others. But this one is very slow, pensive, deep, reflective, haunting.
You start right into it?
Yeah.
Thank you.
blood count. Thank you.
Should we try to hear?
Okay, after a brief discussion, we're going to close tonight on a high note. This is something you probably won't hear. All right, this is a Chicoria composition. A high note?
All right. Don, it's
your birthday.
We just got here.
Oh, man. You just got here? Okay. Is it okay if we...
You can have more than one high note.
All right. All right.
Can we do gold earrings?
Yeah.
I think it's over there in there. Somewhere.
Anything.
This is a sort of an arrangement of... was sort of become a gypsy tune. I guess it started out that way, a soundtrack from the movie Golden Earrings, and it's entitled Golden Earrings. I got the bright idea after listening to the Schubert trio in E flat a number of times. It just came to me that maybe there's a way to combine those two. So sort of did, or pasted them together. I don't know if you would call it combined, but this is an arrangement of Golden Earrings with the opening by Schubert. I originally titled it Franz and the Golden Earrings. And there's never been any proof positive that he ever wore earrings. But I did come across the, I don't know what the technique was, what the medium was. Might have been a lithograph. Actual photo portrait of Schubert, and there was a discoloration on the lower lobe of his right ear, which suggested to me that maybe this guy did wear earrings, you know, who knew? So anyway, this is the piece dedicated to Franz and the golden earrings. You know, also when the tango comes in, it'll be that tango reed that I told you about before the break.
Thank you.
Thank you. So keep a lookout for any documentation, okay? The earring thing, I mean. All right, now we will finish up with this Chicoria piece. You won't probably hear a violin and an accordion do this very often. But it's certainly doable, but this is a very festive piece. In fact, it's entitled La Fiesta. And we usually live through it pretty good. See what happens. Meet you at the end. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bravo.
Don Stille. Daniela Bisenius. How about this?
Thank you.
70 never looked so great. Happy birthday, Don.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, everybody, for coming out to celebrate.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for coming. One more?
Yeah.
Yes.
How about the tango?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And to you as well.
Yeah. And by the way, I will let Don and Daniela take this out while they figure out this next tune. Let me just quickly say, take these cards with you if you like. Sign up for our mailing list if you like. The emails that I send out every week come from me to you. I don't spam you. They don't go anywhere else. I don't share it. And please do come back, and thank you for your support.
Okay, we will do... we're just trying to figure out what would be a tasteful way to... Whoa.
Part of the act. It's all part of the act.
You sure you won't consider those accordion lessons? I know a salesman. This is actually a popularized Latin tune entitled Besame Mucho, which I think it literally translates to kiss me much, or kiss me a lot anyway. And we do it as in kind of a tango flavor. And this is it, Besame Mucho. We're going to do this, just announcing a sort of a disclaimer, because this is being streamed. Technically, this tune is in ABA form, and very often it's done AABA, and we realize that. So I just want everybody to know. So, you know, it's not a case where we didn't have any learning or anything. Yeah, exactly. The bridge is a little bit different place.
Bravo, Roger.
So, Besame Mucho, AABA. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you. From our hearts to yours, Daniela Bisenius. Yours truly, Don Stille. Thank you. And our host, our wonderful host, Steve.
Steve
Rashid.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Steve. I hope we see you all again soon sometime.
When? Thank you.
It's a good question.
Thanks very much, folks. Have a great night. Come on back.